Al Jazeera Podcasts.
Today, it led the movement against apartheid in South Africa under the leadership of Nelson Mandela.
Give the enemies of peace and liberty no space to take us back to the dark hell of apartheid.
30 years later, the African National Congress could lose its majority in South Africa's parliament for the first time. I'm Malika Bilal, and this is The Take.
My name is Lester Kivett, and I'm a journalist and broadcaster based in Cape Town, South Africa. I'm a presenter on Cape Talk Radio, morning show on Cape Talk Radio.
So, Lester, welcome to The Take. Let's rewind to 1994, when the African National Congress won a sweeping victory in South Africa's first free election, marking the official end to white apartheid rule. What do you remember about that time?
I hold special significance for this year's election. 30 years after 1994, I was 10 years old in 1994. The first big news event that I can remember was when I was 6 years old, in fact, and that was around the announcement of the release of Nelson Mandela, a flurry of excitement by my parents and my older relatives.
There's Mr. Mandela, Mr. Nelson Mandela, a free man, taking his first steps into a new South Africa. His first public appearance in nearly three decades.
I wanted to be at the Cape Town City Centre on the day of Nelson Mandela's release, but because of concerns of safety, I wasn't allowed to join them when Nelson Mandela would have made his first public statement and address after 27 years in imprisonment.
Our primary task remains to unite our people across the length and breadth of our country.
So since then, I've always had a keen interest in news, current affairs, and particularly South Africa's history. And so when 1994, the 27th of April arrives, not only is it our first election, it's also my sister's fourth birthday on that day. So, of course.
It's a formative memory there.
That's right. So, cool memories being made around that time. But I remember how in the house that my parents still live in today, it overlooks a community hall, which was used as a polling venue. And because of my parents' support of the ANC, outside our homes were banners and flags. So our home became some sort of attraction for people who would go vote, filled with all sorts of strangers. And I remember plenty of clinking of champagne and singing of songs.
Oh, I love that.
And so I have an incredibly fond memory of the 27th of April, 1994. And just like I was with my parents when they went to vote, I cast an early special ballot earlier this week on Monday and doing it as a family.
Thank you for sharing that. So I'm picturing these ANC banners flying outside of your childhood home. How important was the party's victory back then for South Africa as a whole?
Incredibly important. The ANC as leader of the liberation movement at that time, remember the ANC was banned in South Africa up until 1990 and operated in exile. Nelson Mandela, largely cast as some form of saint in today's pop culture, but Nelson Mandela was a revolutionary. Nelson Mandela was a founding member of the armed resistance movement for the ANC, Umkhonto we Sizwe. But he was chosen by the ANC and the mass democratic movement to be the face of liberation in South Africa. Me seeing Nelson Mandela for the first time, it was in that 1994 campaign, and I remember with my crayons at the time, making and drawing a little ANC flag. So a lot of my memories are through the lens of being but a 10-year-old boy in Cape Town.
Yeah, yeah, wow. So that is the historical backdrop. But I want to fast forward to today and read you a few international headlines on how this election is looking for the ANC of today. Here's one. Elections that could spell the end of ANC dominance. Another. South Africa election could bring the biggest political shift since it became a democracy. That's just a snippet of international media. How is this playing in South Africa? And what does it say about today's ANC that people are even talking about them losing their 30-year majority?
There are two statistics that I will cite from a recent Africa Barometer report led by the Institute for Justice and Reconciliation in South Africa. One is that about a third of South Africans, registered voters, about 32%, are undecided on who to vote for this election. Another worrying statistic from the survey is that there's up to 70% of South Africans who have grown disgruntled with democracy itself, and that they would actually appreciate some form of benevolent dictator. Now, the research goes to show that South Africa isn't alone in this phenomenon, but I think this is compounded in South Africa with this great disillusionment in the ANC, particularly for a generation who have no recollection of apartheid besides through the stories of their parents. So we look at an unemployment rate of South Africa of about 32%. Of course, the world has been through a pandemic over the last 5 years, so an economy struggling to get back on its feet, not just in South Africa, but other parts of the world. But that doesn't excuse the deep developmental challenges that is largely man-made and at the hand of the ANC, largely because of maladministration, incompetence, and fraud, and gross corruption.
Wow. A lot of that turmoil, people point to a lot of it happening during the leadership of former President Jacob Zuma. Economic problems, but also these corruption allegations that kept rising to the surface that eventually led Zuma to resign. So when South Africa's current president, Cyril Ramaphosa, came in 2018, he talked about a new dawn after what he called 9 wasted years under Zuma.
We should put all the negativity that has dogged our country behind us, because a new dawn is upon us and a wonderful dawn has arrived.
Polls indicate that he is popular, Ramaphosa. But if the ANC loses ground this election, does it mean that he has failed to deliver on that new dawn?
I think we don't lose the irony that Cyril Ramaphosa was Jacob Zuma's deputy president at the time.
Right.
But look, there was a wave of optimism when Cyril Ramaphosa became president. He rode in on a ticket of New Dawn. He rode in on a ticket of a popular song in South Africa by a quite well-known jazz musician under the theme Tumamina.
I wanna be there when the people start to turn it around, when they triumph.
Tumamina means send me. So it was really a call for action that he is the man that should be sent by South Africa to resolve the problems. But what has happened over the last while since Cyril Ramaphosa has been president? We've seen geopolitical issues, particularly around the war in Ukraine involving Russia and how that has impacted on global markets. Also, internal instability that has impacted negatively on his presidency. Cyril Ramaphosa has largely been seen as hapless, indecisive, and it was even an interesting article by a well-known political journalist in South Africa who asked if Cyril Ramaphosa was quiet quitting on South Africans. Remember, as a man who was deployed by the ANC to be part of a new black industrialist class. This is a billionaire in South African rands, and many questioned whether he even wanted the job to be president.
Wow. So quiet quitting for our non-millennial listeners was this phenomenon of people sort of stepping back from working in the hopes that they could just fade away from that job. That's what one analyst has accused the president of.
Yeah, you just fade away. You slowly step back and into a shell. But I think some of the criticism that has been labeled against Cyril Ramaphosa is simply against what type of leader he is. Cyril Ramaphosa was a union leader in South Africa in the 1980s. He was a constitutional lawyer. So consensus, deliberation, negotiation, and building social compacts is hard-baked into Cyril Ramaphosa's DNA and style of leadership. And of course, when you've been experiencing 10 years of gross corruption in South Africa, you are looking for action. You're looking for prosecuting authorities to serve indictments and see people on trial. Cyril Ramaphosa, as the constitutionalist he is, has said, I'm not getting involved in any investigation by the National Prosecuting Authority. It is an independent organ of state. So that hands-off approach has not sit well with many South Africans and South African commentators who were really looking for a stronger leader when Cyril Ramaphosa came into power in 2018.
What happens if the ANC doesn't win a majority? That's after the break. So Lester, what is driving South Africans to the polls? What are the main issues they're thinking about as they cast their votes? You mentioned a few already, unemployment soaring. What else?
South Africa is mired in deep developmental challenges at the moment. We've seen some impressive growth in various sectors of our economy, in our social cohesion, in how we identify as South Africans, but that hasn't stopped a deep malaise when it comes to the lack of developmental efforts. I've mentioned an unemployment rate that is a deep concern. Violent crime continues to be a major concern in South Africa. There are 85 murders that take place on average every day in South Africa. We have a crisis in South Africa of trauma and how we have not sufficiently dealt with the scars of pre-1994. The vast majority of interpersonal violence in South Africa happens between people who know each other.
Very big issues. Okay, so if those are the things that people are voting on, let's talk about who they're hoping can solve that. Who are the main players in this parliamentary election that our international listeners should be aware of?
The Democratic Alliance is South Africa's main opposition party. It's a party that grows from white liberal parties who were engaged and involved in an apartheid parliament. John Steenhuisen is the official leader of the opposition.
Unlike all these other parties in this election, the DA doesn't make promises about what we're going to do one day. We don't kaluma, kaluma, kaluma. The Democratic Alliance delivers, delivers, delivers.
It's unlikely that the Democratic Alliance will meet any form of threshold that there's a likelihood that he would win a parliamentary election for president. The third largest political party is, of course, not of interest to many people because it is the rabble-rousing firebrand politician Julius Malema of the Economic Freedom Fighters.
The character of Economic Freedom Fighters will be that of a radical, left, anti-capitalist, anti-imperialist movement with an international outlook anchored by popular grassroots formation and struggle.
This is a man who comes from ANC stock, a former leader in the ANC Youth League. He manages to energize particularly a disenchanted base of young black South Africans who have become disenchanted with the promises of the ANC. He has had to tone down some of his populist far left rhetoric because there comes the introduction of a new political party. Surprise, surprise, another offshoot of the ANC, and this is the MK Party, Umkhonto we Sizwe, led by the former president, Jacob Zuma.
You can ask any South African how the country was at the time. They are trusting me now, they are taking me back where they say that's where, this is the man we trust.
And what Jacob Zuma has managed to do is attract many within the ANC, leaders and ordinary members, to form some form of bloc to challenge the ANC.
Okay, so a lot of options on the ballot. What happens if the ANC doesn't win a majority, and what would that mean for the future of South Africa?
I don't think that Cyril Ramaphosa is at any risk of not winning a second term. I think the ANC is quite prepared to fall around the just at or below 50%. Some of the polls are showing that the best case scenario for the ANC would be somewhere between 45 and 47%. This is would mean that they would need some form of coalition or vote sharing from smaller political parties. So I think the ANC is quite prepared to work in partnership with a smaller party if it comes round 50, 47, 45%. Another scenario is that if the ANC gets closer to 40%, this is a real blow. And this is then when it would have to call on maybe a figure like Julius Malema to form a coalition. This has the markets worried because of Julius Malema's left rhetoric, nationalization, expropriation of land without compensation. There is an option that not too long ago, many South Africans would see as possibly the best option. And that would be to return to a 1994 style government of national unity led by the ANC, but it brings in partners like from the Democratic Alliance, like from the EFF, like from smaller parties to create a government, an administration that sees South Africa rebuilding over the next 5 years.
Lester, you have told us you've already voted, but what do you predict that your Thursday morning is going to look like when you get on the mic on your radio show?
Social media is definitely not an indicator of voter sentiment, but what I'm seeing is, and this has always been a strength of the ANC, is that the ANC has the ability to get its voters out to vote. The ANC traditionally has very strong links to community organizations, civic groups, traditional leaders, even minibus taxi operator organizations. And I wouldn't be surprised if the ANC manages to sneak in just over 50%, because that's what I'm currently seeing in the mobilization of the ANC at the moment. But I am not necessarily a South African that worries about an outcome of the election. Our institutions have proven to be strong and stable. And I am incredibly hopeful that hope that I had as a 10-year-old in 1994, I still carry with me today, in that South Africa has the ability to reset and recalibrate and to grow.
And that's The Take. This episode was produced by Ashish Malhotra, Chloe K. Lee, and Sariel Khalili, with Catherine Newhan, Sonia Bagant, Amy Walters, and me, Malika Bilal. It was edited by Noor Wazwaz. Our sound designer is Alex Roldan. Alexandra Locke is The Take's executive producer, and Ney Alvarez is Al Jazeera's head of audio. We'll be back tomorrow.